I'm Dan Collins with Mercy Medical Center in Baltimore, Maryland, and you're watching Medoscopy. On Medoscopy, we aim our camera lens at all things medical. Today's guest will help us examine cancer surgery and some of the latest research in that field. Mercy's Dr. Debashish Bose, surgical oncologist with the Institute for Cancer Care at Mercy. Dr. Bose, thanks for being with us today.
My pleasure.
I understand you have a family connection to Mercy. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes. Almost a lifetime ago, my parents came to this country and came to Baltimore. Both of them were physicians, newly minted physicians, and so they came under programs that the United States was engaged in to try and attract physicians to the country because there was a doctor shortage. And so the offer was training and then, of course, a visa to come and work and live in the United States. So my parents took advantage of that. And my mother actually did her residency training here at Mercy Hospital. It remains affiliated with the University of Maryland residency. So those connections started in the late 60s, and my mother had her entire career here. My father also, who's a general surgeon, he also operated here throughout his career. Both have now retired for a while, but during the course of all of that, I spent several summers here working in various jobs, doing research, among other things. When I was in high school, I actually was one of the volunteers. And even in medical school, I rotated here on the general surgery service. So there are people here at this hospital who have known me almost all my life and have seen me grow up in front of their eyes. And it's a very special place to come back to for me because of those connections. It really is a home.
So what was your impression of Mercy as a youth? And did that experience here help make you decide to go into medicine?
Well, for sure. When we talk about, you know, what kinds of things influence us, one of the things for kids, I think, is who do they look up to? Who are they surrounded by that they find good role models, people that they would model on themselves? And I think throughout my childhood and then young adult life, those role models were always here. I remember Sister Thomas, for example, Sister Helen, of course. We always had a lot of family friends who were the other physicians at Mercy. And so I grew up in that community, among other doctors. In fact, our neighbors across the street were the Dinkers, and Dr. Robert Dinker was the chief of radiology here for decades. Dr. Eckholt, who was a neurologist, was also one of our neighbors and one of our closest family friends. And so you can imagine those connections were not just to the hospital, but to the community that was involved in taking care of patients here and building Mercy as an institution.
So basically, from the time that you can remember all the way up through adulthood, you were surrounded by doctors, either friends or family. So it seems like your future was somewhat ordained. But was this what you always wanted to do? Did you always think you were going to be a doctor?
Well, I did rebel, as young folks do. So, and I would say that I did that at a very good time. So when I went to college, I decided to look at other fields and other lines of education, and I actually majored in politics. And but by the end of college, I kind of felt like, no, medicine is what I want to do.
What drew you to politics?
There's philosophy, there's history, There's a bit of economics. You need to know a little bit about religion. In the end, it's the study of how do people organize and how do people think of themselves and others, and what kinds of factors go into how we both unify ourselves as human beings and divide ourselves. And of course, human history is, you know, rife with both good and bad examples of what occurs when that happens. So it was interesting.
The variety of things that you were talking about, history, economics, philosophy, religion, allows you to apply yourself in many different ways. And of course, that also lends itself as to your work as a physician, does it not?
I would say so. You know, one of the hallmarks of being a doctor, according to my father, is that, and this was according to one of his professors of medicine, which was that a doctor is first and foremost a learned person, right? A certain breadth of experience and knowledge allows us to find that empathy with people who are very different from ourselves.
You're a surgical oncologist, but you have a particular interest in treating cancer of the liver and pancreas. And for the past 5 years, you've been using a cutting edge form of technology. Can you tell me about that?
Sure. So what we call scientifically irreversible electroporation is a technique of killing cells, essentially. And what that does is it puts cells in a piece of tissue in an electric field. Those cells, which can be imagined as sort of bags of fluid, right, then develop holes in that bag or their skin. And if they can't close them back up, they have a hard time keeping what's outside out and what's inside in. And that difference is actually one of the things that keeps cells living, that they maintain a different environment inside themselves than exists outside themselves. So, unable to do that, they die. Cancer cells are no different from any other cells in that regard. If you cause them to have that kind of injury to their membranes, their skins, they'll die. So what we try to do is put tumors in an electric field in order to try and essentially kill off the viable tissue. Let's say a tumor is wrapped around a blood vessel and we treat it with electroporation. The blood vessel doesn't get damaged. And even the cell lining of that blood vessel can repopulate. And that's an important difference because some blood vessels are not blood vessels that we can take out. And this is particularly true in terms of the pancreas and tumors, for example, in the head of the pancreas that may involve some critical blood vessels and therefore render that tumor what we call unresectable or locally advanced. So it's very specific for use in locally advanced pancreatic cancer in the sense that while the technology is FDA approved for ablation of tumors generally, it's a very specific use in the pancreas for those kinds of tumors. We can also use it in other areas of the body. There is growing experience with using this technology on prostate cancers. And there is also growing experience in using this on tumors in the liver, both tumors that have spread to the liver and tumors that have arisen in the liver, when for a variety of reasons, we may find that electroporation is a better option than other forms of ablation or surgery. And we participate here at Mercy in studies on the use of electroporation in pancreatic cancer. So that's the technology. It goes under the trade name Nanoknife. And it's the common misconception that it's actually a knife. It's not. It's actually basically long needles with part of the tips exposed to create that electric field. And so using an ultrasound, those needles are placed in the appropriate spots around a tumor, and then we deliver the energy. so that the electric field can then do its work on the cells.
We'll take a break and return after these messages.
In tonight's Woman's Doctor, there's a special treatment for liver and pancreatic cancers. It's called Nanoknife, and it kills cancer cells. The advanced system doesn't rely on heat, but instead it uses a more natural method that destroys only targeted tissue. That spares critical structures, including vessels, nerves, and ducts. Mercy Medical Center Dr. Debashish Bose says after a patient undergoes chemotherapy and radiation, surgeons are able to treat tumors using the Nanoknife system.
It consists of basically surrounding a tumor with needle probes that generate an electric field. That electric field actually induces the cancer cells to die without causing thermal damage. And the reason to use the Nanoknife is often because tumors can be close to or even surround vital structures.
Now, doctors can treat tumors they would not otherwise be able to remove in a conventional way.
As viewers know, one regular feature of our program is a sort of show and tell, where guests bring in something, some item, could be a book, a photograph. We don't know what, but we are about to find out. In this case, Dr. Bose, what have you brought for us to see today?
Well, in this bag is one of the simplest tools one can think of that helps us make bread. And this is known as a baker's couche. And it's really as simple as a large sheet of a very heavy-duty linen. And this is a French item, and it's typically used to make baguettes. So as you can imagine, the dough is rolled and shaped, and then it gets housed, and it's a little difficult to do it here, but this couche is thick enough and heavy enough that you can house the rolls and then shore up the sides. And so during the final proofing of the loaf, the baguette, it's supported on the sides, which helps give it that rounded shape instead of just flattening out. And I bring it not just because, as many people during the pandemic have learned to bake, I was one of them. But even more importantly, I think, and this was also pre-pandemic for me and my family, I became very interested in the way we eat. And I think it's extremely important, not just for physical health, but for what it means to, you know, our family, to my kids, when we cook and we provide them a meal. It's for us, it's like sometimes it's something very quick and easy. Other times it's something more elaborate, but it's been just incredible, especially when we're spending so much more time together instead of out and about, to share a meal with your family, to make it yourself, make the bread yourself, you know, cook the meat yourself, cook your vegetables yourself, cook fresh foods, cook it with love, share it with your family and your friends. And so this is why I brought this very simple item.
Is that the flour I see?
You can see some flour on there, yeah. It's seen some use.
In my experience, most surgeons tell me their favorite place to be is the OR. As a surgeon yourself, would you agree, and why do you think that is?
I do agree. There is an aspect of being in the OR that, for me, is a combination of a kind of a craftsman's space, right, where you can get lost in the work you're doing and time doesn't figure into your thoughts, right? And I can't speak for every surgeon, but, you know, we do some pretty long cases, but it never feels long. You become engrossed in what you're doing. And I think to some degree to be a good surgeon, and I think there are many people who are like this, and that's why the answer that the OR is my favorite place to be is because it's not just loving what you do, it's that sort of a little bit of a trance state that you go into when you're doing that thing that you are very skilled at, have done before, but you're catching all the little nuances that are a little bit different about each patient. And you're catching all the unspoken and, you know, things that are not in textbooks anywhere. And that's why it's the practice of surgery, right? We are very much like craftspeople. Of course, I love meeting patients in our clinic. Don't get me wrong. I'm not one of those people who doesn't want to meet people. I love the interaction with our patients. I like to be able to see them recover on the floor and, you know, in the hospital and then afterwards when they're home. So for me, I'm still kind of a people person that way. And, you know, I'm not a recluse and I just want to be in the operating room. There are people who are like that, but that's not what it's about for me. You learn as a surgeon, you're an important piece, but you're just a piece of that machinery to which so many other people are also critical to caring for people. And our system is set up that way for very good reasons, so that we deliver the best care that we can.